Okay, we're going to go through the product and services area of setups. And so I come over here to my handy gear, over to account and settings, and then we have our sales category. And if I scroll down to products and services, this is where we're going to be focused on this video. So first of all, the first option is, do we want to show products and services on sales forms? Now, if we don't, if we choose not to, let me go ahead and edit this and turn it off, right? It turns off the SKU, of course, because we're not using products and services, so there's nothing to tie a SKU to. So I say save, all of these pop-ups and warnings come up, but when I go look at an invoice as an example, oops, sales invoices, and I create a new invoice in here, when I scroll down here, see, now I have the option to put in information, but I can't tie it to a specific item, right? So it's just going to go in to a GL account code like other revenues or something like that. So let's go ahead and put in an invoice to see the results. So to Adam's Casita, and the service day was today, and whatever description, did fun things. I do have quantity and rate, which we're about to talk about in a minute. 10 hours at $200 an hour. I didn't pick that up. I don't know why. So $2,000. And then when I save this transaction, okay, now when I come and look behind the scenes as to what is happening with this transaction, down here under more, and I see my transaction journal. So it's going to show me my debits and credits. So what happens behind the scenes, right, is it just goes directly to sales, okay? So I can't decide where that is going in different revenue accounts. It's just going to go to one revenue account. Okay, so if we have pretty simplistic setup, we can do that, but I always suggest there's always some depth that you can build in your file, and of course, the more data you put in, the more reporting you're going to be able to get. So showing products and services, even if it's just two services that you offer, definitely it's best to segment that so you can run subledger reports to say, okay, how much did I do in plumbing services versus electrical services, or how much did I do in materials costs for contractors versus materials costs for end users, clients or residents, whatever it is. So it's as much as we can build in, we always want to. So anyway, turn on products and services. Show the SKU. All the SKU is, when we go and we set up an item, it's your product number. It can be the the number that the client recognizes. It can be a barcode type number, right? So it's just different than the product number in there. It's a separate field. Okay. Then we have price rules. This is where you turn on or off price rules. We're going to have a whole bunch of videos on price rules, but when we come in to our price, our invoices in here, sorry, and go to products and services, I can come in and I have price rules turned on, so I'm going to see that here under more. And so why would we use price rules? This is where if you have particular customers or, certain customers of a certain type, or you can select them individually, if you have particular customers that you want to give different pricing than the standard MSRP that you have set up in the system. So why would you want to do that? If you have like a wholesale customer, somebody, or maybe you're a supply house, let's just say. So I have a little shop and I supply people, but when contractors come in, or maybe interior designers come in or something like that, I want to encourage them to come back. So I give them a discount because I know that they're going to be marking it up to their customers. So I give them a discount to continue to come back. But then, for Marjorie, who is just a resident in her home and she wants to come buy some product from me, she doesn't get that same discount as somebody who's going to be a more repeat customer for me, right? So that might be a reason why we set up price rules. The other reason, too, I see a lot of times is we're under contract with a big organization, right? So if we're working with like a Costco, or we're working with a Whole Foods or something like that, we might have a contract price for them. That we need to make sure that we're giving them the contract price that we have set up. So put in the rule name, choose the customers, which type of products does this apply to, is a percentage, fixed amount, or custom price, over or under, right, MSRP, which is MSRP is basically the sales price that you have set up when you set up the item. Is there any rounding? What's the start date and end date? So it can be a promotional period. And then, of course, you can give a per item price as well. So pretty cool. If you're familiar with desktop, it kind of combines two different things in that desktop has. So, because it has price rules and price levels in desktop, they're two separate features, and this kind of combines them both together. Okay, track quantity and rate slash price. So what this is going to do is, as we noticed on the form earlier, it's just going to give you the quantity and rate field. So if you, as an example, bid on jobs, you just bid $2,000. You don't bid 10 hours at $200 an hour. You just doing $2,000, then maybe you don't need this quantity and rate. But again, it does kind of tend to, especially if you're dealing with any materials or anything like that, quantity and rate is super important. So you always want to come in here and turn that on. Even when you're dealing in hours, I always say it's good to, because if you quoted, I mean, how did you get to the $2,000 spot, right? You're taking into account some time, and you're taking into account, you know, maybe some materials, whatever it is. I always think it's good to put more information in the system, right? So I quoted 10 hours, but it actually took me 20 hours. So maybe next time I need to quote differently, you know, as much information as you can put in there, take out of your brain, put in the system, then it can be helpful in the future. Then the last thing, of course, is, are we going to track inventory quantity on hand, right? So this is basically setting up inventory. The difference between turning this on or leaving it off is when you receive in the materials, is it going to hit my P&L right away? Or is it going to hit my balance sheet as an asset to the company that I haven't utilized yet? So only want to track quantity on hand if you actually are maintaining stock. If you're doing mostly pass-through, you don't necessarily need, meaning I go out to the job, I'm an electrician, I show up at the house, I see that they need to fix five different light switches, and I run over to Home Depot and grab them and then come back in and fix the light switches, right? It's all like the purchase should flow through to the P&L at the point of usage, which is that same day. So I don't need to maintain inventory for that, right? Where you really want inventory, it complicates things, right? So you don't want to overcomplicate your system. Where you really want to turn on inventory is if you are going to a supply house again and buying a whole bunch of switches and stocking them at your warehouse. Now, why would you do that? You're like, oh, this is a pain. But the hope would be, right, that you are saving money by buying in bulk as opposed to buying retail. So, you know, these are just things to consider. But don't turn it on unless it's absolutely necessary, because it does open up quite a bit of extra work to reconcile inventory, have to count inventory periodically, and then make sure that we're not going negative, right? So definitely call and ask. All right, that's product and services.